This is the latest version of the Kawasaki Ninja 1000. And for 2020, it's got a whole bunch of features, including the addition of an SX at the end of the name. Now, with those features comes a fairly substantial hike in the price. So what we're going to try and do here today is to see whether this is still the great value for money offering it used to be, but also just to see how it handles the average Indian riding environment.
But first off, let's start with the changes you'll see on the bike. When we picked up the motorcycle from Anson Kawasaki in Mumbai, it was clear that the overall design is quite similar to the previous 2019 model. The most obvious change is that Kawasaki has ditched the old bike's twin exhaust setup and has moved to one large can on the right side. But there are more differences, and the side fairings have been redesigned, while the windscreen is a new four-step adjustable unit. There are some smaller details too, like the switch gear that is borrowed from the Kawasaki H2SX, or the sleek new indicators, and even the new mirrors. One of the more important changes though is the addition of a new 4.3-inch TFT display. This looks crisp from the rider's point of view, and it has some interesting information like maximum lean angle, as well as meters that show real-time brake and throttle input, and even how the bike is pitching back and forth as a result of these inputs. Of course, this is quite pointless because you'll almost never be able to look down and see this information in real time, but it is a cool thing to brag about. Oh, and how can we proceed without talking about that gigantic, ridiculously over-engineered Sari guard, which thankfully can be removed. Also, in case you were wondering, the crash protection installed on this motorcycle is aftermarket and it does not come as standard. Overall, the Ninja 1000SX continues in the spirit of being a sporty yet touring-oriented motorcycle, one whose dimensions are designed with an equal focus on speed and performance, as well as comfort and practicality.
So there's no getting around the fact that this is a large motorcycle. The fuel tank feels big and chunky, about as much as you'd expect when you hear that it can hold 19 liters of petrol. And then there's a C-Type. Now, Kawasaki says that this is 820mm tall, but it actually feels like a little more than that to me. Personally, I really like it, but I do feel like shorter riders might get put off by that seat.
It may be big, but this bike is actually quite welcoming to ride. In fact, we rode through a day with all sorts of weather conditions, and because this is no time to be falling ill, you will see me in my rain gear in some of the shots. Despite the conditions, the Ninja 1000SX kept me comfortable over a 13-hour day of shooting, and while the rider ergonomics are fairly sporty, they certainly aren't what you'd call cramped or committed. The taller new seats are also very comfy over long periods. While the chassis is more or less unchanged for 2020, Kawasaki did make a 0.5-degree reduction in the steering angle. This doesn't sound like a lot, but it's resulted in a noticeably lighter steering, both in the city and at higher speeds, and this has helped to address one of the issues with the previous model. However, the most enjoyable thing about this motorcycle is the suspension. The rebound adjustable rear shock with its convenient remote preload adjuster is the same as before, but Kawasaki says they've improved the low-speed damping characteristics for the 41mm fully adjustable USD fork. The result is a bike that glides along in a way you could genuinely call plush. The Ninja 1000SX happily soaks in all forms of rough patches, and with its hefty curb weight of 238 kilos, it isn't very affected by grooves in the road or changing surface heights. Of course, this is not an adventure bike, so nasty potholes are still something to avoid, but otherwise, this bike really feels quite effortless and stress-free on our roads.
In fact, you'll quickly get so comfortable on the road that you will need to periodically remind yourself that this bike has just 135 mm of ground clearance, so take it easy over the speed breakers.
We'd actually suggest that you slow right down over nasty speed breakers, and to do so, you'll have to rely on the twin 300mm disc Nissan front brake setup. Now, like many other aspects of this bike, the brakes have a soft initial bite, but they get the job done well enough. And that's a relief because this motorcycle packs a powerhouse of an engine. The spec sheet still looks very familiar with just over 140 horsepower, but Kawasaki has put in a lot of work to get this engine to Euro 5 or BS6 spec. And that includes new camshaft profiles as well as a redesigned intake and exhaust system. Kawasaki consistently makes some of the smoothest inline 4 engines out there, and the Ninja 1000's motor almost feels electric at low RPM. There are some high frequency vibrations that creep in when you rev it out, but at gentle speeds, the Ninja just hums along in a delightfully tractable manner. The new ride-by-wire throttle system is also almost perfectly tuned, and it works smoothly regardless of which of the four new riding modes you use. Now usually, my opinion of full-blown 1000cc superbikes on our roads is that the risk-to-reward ratio just isn't worth it. But that's not the case with this motorcycle.
The Ninja 1000 is different. This engine has a super solid mid-range and it only revs out to about 10,500 RPM. So you don't need to redline it like an anti-social lunatic just to have a good time. But what I really like is that this engine feels absolutely mellow, humming along at about 100 kph, and it doesn't feel frustrated if you want to ride at gentle speeds. To me, that makes this bike a real pleasure to ride on our roads.
Of course, with so much power on offer, you can scream to very high speeds very quickly. As always, the final decision is made by your right wrist, but this Ninja's calm demeanor certainly helps you to stay well behaved. It's a similar story with the handling, and while it certainly isn't designed for the racetrack, show the big Ninja a set of smooth corners and this motorcycle is quite happy to play along. You will need to put some muscle into quick direction changes, but the stock Bridgestone S22 tyres have superb grip in the dry while staying reasonably confident on wet surfaces. No matter whether you ride the bike fast or slow, the new bi-directional quick shifter only enhances the experience, although it can be slightly hesitant on downshifts. Keeping the rider safe is a refined electronics package with a 6-axis IMU. In addition to the previous motorcycle's 3-stage traction control and 2 power modes, the Ninja now gets 4 riding modes. It also gets cornering ABS as standard, and the overall electronics package is quite smooth in the way it functions. With the switch to ride-by-wire, Kawasaki has also been able to include cruise control for the first time. Finally, you can download Kawasaki's Rideology app to access a number of Bluetooth-enabled functions. And for a rather hefty sum of money, Kawasaki will even sell you optional panniers and a top box that are designed to neatly interface with the motorcycle. All of the stuff we've talked about comes for a price of ₹10.79 lakh ex-showroom, which is about ₹50,000 more than the previous BS4 model. Nevertheless, even at this price, the Ninja 1000 SX is vastly cheaper than any other bike with similar power or features.
Given all the additions and improvements Kawasaki has made to this motorcycle, I think the price is still very decent and you get a lot of bike for your money. Just remember though, this is not a ZX10R with just 60 horsepower less. It's a much bigger, softer and gentler machine in general. But for those of you who want an inline 4 experience without the spine and wrist torture that generally goes along with it, I think you'll really like what this bike has to offer.